Hello and welcome to the art collection of the European Patent Office. My name is Lisa Zeitz. I'm the editor-in-chief of Weltkunst, the magazine based in Berlin. And I'm today talking to Annemieke Redeyk, who's a scientist and working at the European Patent Office based in Munich and in Den Haag, and Professor Julian Niederrümelin, a philosophy professor and former culture minister of Germany. So today, in these strange times, the times of COVID, when the public is deprived of art and artists are deprived of their public, there's a very welcome surprise. The European Patent Office, who has a large collection of art, which was under the radar for about 40 years, is opening up and sharing its art in digital ways with the public. About 1,000 artworks collected over the last 4 decades have remained mostly hidden from outsiders. Not from insiders. The members of the European Patent Office are surrounded by art. And so I'm first asking Annemieke Redeyk, how is it working in an environment filled with art, and how does it feel for you personally?
In one word, I would say it's very inspiring. I love the collection of the EPO. I consider that working amongst these beautiful works of art, there's kind of a free space that has been created. The artists have created their works with an intention, but in the end, we're all invited to be curious, to be inquisitive, and to have our own thoughts when we look at them. And within this free space that has been created, everybody is allowed in. We all have a place. And I think that that is very important for me. We're all important as EPO employees, and we are allowed to work and to contribute amongst these beautiful works of art.
The first thing that we saw in the beginning of this talk is an installation in Munich in the address Pschorrhöfe, which shows a molecular looking big installation by Thomas Saraceno in the staircase. But of course, there are also all over the offices and in other public spaces, there are different works. Can you name a favorite one, that one that inspires you especially?
Mm-hmm. Well, you already named a very special one, Lisa. I would definitely start with that piece of art. It's not in the building where I'm normally working, but this work with the hemispheres in a kind of spider web definitely are intriguing and link your thoughts to environmental issues in the world and how as a society we can take responsibility there. If I am invited to mention a few more, I would definitely also mention the work of Lilith Hirnega and Martin Karlsbeek in The Hague, the work Blossoming, which is kind of flying above the cafeteria, a place where in normal circumstances we are, well, almost once a day discussing together with colleagues. Some other works which I find particularly inspiring are the works that are quite non-material, the ones made of light. There is one in the cafeteria in the Schürhöfe. It depicts the word idea. But I imagine people moving in this cafeteria don't even think of that this reflects an idea. It's simply the free space of their cafeteria where they are on a daily basis. There's also a light work at the entrance of the meeting room in the big ISAR building, where simply it's movement and light that creates the image and that you're undergoing. There's also in Berlin, the work Morse, another, let's say, reflection of light in combination with technology. I find it very special that the EPO has collected these works of art that are both expressive and also a little bit technical in nature.
Herr Niederrümelin, I would like to ask you, how can it be that art inspires scientists? We just heard one talk, a live scientist. Mm-hmm. But you also have a historic perspective on this. I mean, this goes on for ages. How would you say art can inspire science?
Well, the strange thing is, if you look back to European cultural history, there is obviously a close connection between innovation in art and innovation in science. So let's pick up some characteristic periods of time. So classic Greek, this little bit more than 100 years, Plato, Aristotle, Thucydides, and so on. On the one hand, a very, very dynamic development of art and a very dynamic development of philosophy that is more or less the collection of sciences and humanities as we know it now. And then later on, there is still much formation, education, erudition, that what is called Bildung in German, that cannot be translated in the Hellenistic times. But the phase of innovation is more or less over. So this is strange. And we have the same observations in the late Roman, antique times. And then again, if you look some more than 1,000 years later, in Renaissance humanism in Italy, within a few decades, also in redetecting what there was many decades ago, strangely enough, again, a movement towards a wholly new perspective in art and science. And again, one third example maybe, so end of 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. So radical, radical cut with traditions in art and in physics, to give one example, likewise. So at the same time, 1905 is the year in which Albert Einstein published his five famous articles, so Annus Mirabilis of physics. And at the same time, you get paradigm shifts in art. So I think if we neglect art in the development of our culture, then we neglect innovation changes in general.
So artists inspire scientists and scientists inspire art. So it's probably asking what was first, the chicken or the egg. But do you have an opinion on that?
No, I would say these periods in history are characterized by a certain atmosphere of openness and of getting rid of authorities. So this is the common trait. And this, so to say, fosters developments likewise in society in general. Cultural history is also, if you look to life world changes, these are also very apparent in these periods I mentioned, and science and art. So I wouldn't say one is the cause for the other. So innovation in art is not maybe the cause of innovation in science and vice versa. It's the general atmosphere. And this general atmosphere depends a lot on individual freedom, individualism, diversity, openness.
Well, and there is nothing more innovative than inventions. And of course, the patent office is just the institution taking care of inventions and their patents. So when we think of the characteristics of the art collection, there's always some kind of touch of technology, nature, art. The interplay between these becomes apparent. And I find it, especially with the works that have emerged in the last couple of years, that science is taking an extraordinary place within the arts. When you think of, let's say we are back to Tomás Saraceno, an Argentine artist working in Berlin with a very big studio. I was lucky to visit it once and to see what's going on there. He cultivates spiders. He studies spider webs and their intricate architectures. He is also very interested in trying to find a way to fly without fuel, without fossil fuel. So he devised very thin fabrics that are heated by the sun. So you have very dark black fabric, huge balloons. I was running around with one, and I saw the effect of the sun. The sun heats the air inside these balloons, and then this whole balloon starts flying with nothing but sunlight. So it's really amazing how, in a way, trying to save the world and looking into science, making art, all this becomes one. But of course, the scope of the collection is very, very diverse. You were talking about Heringer and van Carlsbeck, the installation in the cafeteria in Den Haag. Annemieke Redijk, I would like to ask you, when you visualize it, it's people who haven't seen it because they can't go to the cafeteria yet. It's like flying objects that have a very, I would say they don't look very scientific. They look like they could be clouds, they could be flowers, they could be just some random objects that have this moment of chance to them. How is it when you go there, a cafeteria, I imagine, filled with people? How are other people reacting to this? Is it, you are fascinated, but is there also within the community, inside the EPO, is there some kind of sentiment, what is this? And I can't eat like this. It's too distracting. How do other people, how do your colleagues, you have more than 6,000 colleagues, how do they react? Has there been any irritation?
In my view, any object that enters the space and is new provokes some discussion, and especially when it's positioned. Indeed, you said very well, Lisa, like hanging islands or clouds in the middle of the cafeteria, it provokes some discussion. And obviously, people have an opinion. Is this beautiful? Maybe some people consider it not so beautiful. But in fact, that's all possible. It's all allowed by the artist and the piece of art. It's kind of non-judgmental. So it leaves this open space to be inquisitive and to be curious. And I think that's also what, let's say, this dialogue has in common with us as a workforce. We all come from different backgrounds, different cultures, and we are stimulated within this free space to be curious, to explore the similarities, but also to explore the differences between our backgrounds. And on this basis, we build this new community, which is in fact indeed our European Patent Office colleagues' workforce community based on the European cultures that we represent. It's very correct indeed that there's always a technical aspect to the works of art represented. It seems that no matter the medium used, the artist questions the status quo and to ask questions like indeed Thomas Sarasengo on environmental issues. But there could also be questions represented on inequality, the limits of power, and what does it mean? What does freedom mean? And for us employees, this provokes indeed the discussion and the dialogue, and that's what brings us together.
So just to name a few more artists that are part of the collection, Olafur Eliasson, also someone who is very interested in science and in environmental changes and possibilities. Carsten Höller, another artist who has a doctorate in agricultural science and is interested in this field science and zoology. And art, of course. Sylvie Fleury, Alicia Quade, who is has interesting experiments going on with gravity. Gregor Hildebrandt, Jorinde Vogt, Wolfgang Tillmans. It's a collection of contemporary art, and starting with a architecture and a program in Germany that helped sculpture in the public spaces to be developed. now also artists that were born after the year 1980. So looking at young artists, looking to diversify and looking to complete the collection so that all 38 member states will be represented. I think the last object that was bought was from an artist from Monaco. There's also one cafeteria in Munich that has an artwork by the Swiss artist John Armleder, and it is almost like a wallpaper with big designs of plankton looking into the microscopic spaces. And I find it actually very smart to have this work in the cafeteria, because plankton is food for so many living things in the ocean, and it's tiny, and now you have it as big, almost 1970s style wallpaper, big ornaments. I find this is a very smart way of playing with the sciences and the arts and food and people. So it's a very smartly devised object. When you, Julian Niederrümelin, you were talking about the Renaissance before and how scientific exploration at the time was in the air, and of course perspective was also opening up literally in painting and sculpture. But I've never seen a period when science itself was so much topic for artists. Can you, when you look back into other periods, does it seem apparent to you that are there any other artists of former centuries that took science on as their own medium?
Yeah, well, there is a famous example. This is Leonardo da Vinci, who was an engineer. He was a physician. Technician, and at the same time sculptor and painter. So I would say it depends a little how you define science. So we have a very narrow definition of science at present. The older interpretation is that there is only gradual change between techniques on the one hand and science on the other, and painting on the third field. So there is a continuum in many periods in history. Also when Archimedes, maybe the most ingenious technician that the world has ever seen, developed his paintings of machines, wooden machines. So these are also pieces of art. So I would say this fine-grained disciplinary partitioning is something we do today, and that should be maybe overcome. And present-day artists try to overcome it. They are interested, for example, in biotechnology, and then develop perspectives how to understand the relation between mind and brain in a totally new form, and many other examples. So maybe we live in a period that is a beginning Renaissance attitude that buries the older partitioning in disciplines and activities that we had since the 19th century.
Julian Niederrümelin, since you're Munich based, and Munich is the headquarters of the European Patent Office, you're probably familiar with some of the artworks that have been part of the spaces. There's Eduardo Paolozzi and others. But I'm curious now, what do you think as a philosopher, what does it mean when an institution like this is taking a stand and showing that they have a big collection and that they are now gradually going to share it online with viewers around the world? What does that mean for an institution like this? And what does this mean maybe for a European idea of creativity and innovation?
Maybe I say a little bit more. You said I'm from Munich. That's true. Born in Munich and grown up in Munich. And for a time, I was the, how do you say in English, the city minister for culture, however you translate it, Kulturreferent der Landeshauptstadt München. And I am coming for a grown up in a family of artists, so father, grandfather, grandmother, and some others in Hildebrand House. That is one of the four big villas, so to say, of big artists, Seidel, von Stuck, and Hildebrand, and so and we when the European Patent Office came to Munich and extended, so a whole quarter of the city was restructured. There were many persons, not only those who lived there, but in general in Munich. They were afraid that the whole quarter loses its character. And in the meantime, I would say, without the European Patent Office, the quarter would be worse off than it is. And part of it is that the European Patent Office is not exclusively engaging in what's its job, so to judge about some innovative techniques, but that it opens to the general public, that it includes art, obviously, if you pass the building. And also the building itself is a piece of art, so to say. So I think the European Patent Office has become, in the meantime, an integral part of the cultural essence of Munich. And this is a very good development. And if you exactly, in this time where, problematically enough, the government said, well, there is a certain part of social activities that is not so relevant, and this is all what we do in our free time, including art and culture, and we close the museums and we close the philharmonies and so on and so forth. And exactly in that moment, the European Patent Office say, well, look, we are engaging in this field and we open to the general public.
It was, I studied in Munich. My art history studies were in Munich. And I remember the work, an older work from the early years of the collection, Eduardo Paolozzi, these technical looking iron sculptures outside. Of course, they become almost like public art. Sculptures in the cities becomes almost like a piece of furniture, but of course, a well-loved piece of furniture that's there, and you don't even question it. It's sitting there, and sometimes it talks to you, and sometimes it doesn't. Or you ride by on your bicycle, or you have a moment to reflect on it. So I find it beautiful that for a long time these sculptures have been outside and have had some kind of communication with the city and its inhabitants. How would you say, Annemieke Redijk, how would you say that the sculptures outside are part of the identity of the people who work there? Is there a meeting point? Do they say, let's meet at the, I don't know, Paolozzi corner or something? Or is this, do you still look at it when you pass it every day?
Like you say, it becomes part of your environment. You refer to that as well, Lisa. It's your environment, you go in the building, and this is your journey into the building. The fact that these sculptures are there is in a way a message, because indeed these sculptures also have again a kind of technical component. I would like to draw here again a little bit of parallel between inventors and artists. It's about questioning the status quo, being innovative, adding something to our environment. And definitely these sculptures have added, simply by being there, have added something to our environment, being present as employees of the European Patent Office. I would like also to draw another parallel. When we talk about transparency and opening up the collection to the wider public, in my view, it indeed fits the current times, where we need to find alternative ways to share experiences, to share dialogue. And in this way, this time we share and we start a dialogue with, the outside EPO people. However, this also fits with the mission that we have, granting patents. Because if you reflect a patent, on the one hand, is a right. On the other hand, this right has only been given when the inventors, when the applicants also share their knowledge with the public. And in that sense, this is really in the spirit that we open up now the collection of the EPO to share with the wider public as our audience.
So you also you have seen the movie, or you have been part of the movie that was made about the collection. It's called Exploring Art at the European Patent Office, and it will be online for everyone to see on the website epo.org. And it's great that artists themselves get to talk. I think Heringa and Van Kalsbeek are part of it, a studio visit there. Have you personally met artists that have installed anything at the headquarters in Den Haag or in Munich? Annemieke Redijk, have you talked to the artists themselves?
For me, it's important not only when I look at the works of art, what do they tell me? It's additionally valuable for me to understand also the drivers of the artists. Why? What type of message do they wish to give to the public? It's always twofold. The message is in the eye of the beholder, but also the artists have an intention when they create the piece of art. Indeed, in this case, I know the artist and I appreciate their work very much.
For me, it's fascinating to see how different people work. Probably inventors work differently too, but I imagine they have some kind of scientific standard, whereas artists can be super scientific, they can be super free, and they can create something with a stroke of a brush. It's just a huge diversity within the process of creating art. So I think that is also a great inspiration to what is possible and what can be thought. Mm-hmm. Thinking about the process of sharing, I know that in the past it was possible for some people to get a rare walk through the collection to see part of it. Now it will be open to everyone. Is there any expectation of what this will what this will mean? What kind of feedback this will bring, or will it be a surprise, Annemieke Redijk? Is there any kind of expectation of what will follow when you open the art collection like this?
To be frank, I don't have the answer to your question. I would have the wish that there would be a lot of people interested, and I would have the wish to share with as many people as possible. And I can only say, when I explain to friends that are sharing this passion for art and cultural expression, they're really impressed by the collection that we have. And unanimously they say, well, we would love to see the collection. So I can only hope that many people will visit either virtually or live the collection when this will be possible.
I also know that it's the engagement and the ongoing engagement of the European Patent Office is very welcome to artists themselves, because of course these are very hard times. There have hardly been any art fairs in the last year. Galleries are struggling, and artists are struggling too. So I find it very important and very welcome that the institution keeps buying art and keeps supporting young artists as well from all over Europe. I thank you very much, both of you, and I thank the European Patent Office.
Thank you. With pleasure.